service it. Okay, couple of things. I understand that your LDAP login IDs might have been activated, but the software lab hasn't incorporated those IDs yet. So I note that you have been using a single login ID today. So the fun of sending an email to someone and getting it back would not happen, because you would be sending a mail to yourself, essentially. Oh, that is working. Your emails are working. Oh, wonderful. Anyway, but the problem is there is no Moodle, and if I have to push this assignment into a location from which all of you can copy, there is no such common directory, common location. The other alternative I thought is I could email it to a tar file to each one of you. So basically tar file combining these two. Unfortunately, the CSAT said that they can't compile all the email IDs of your people with comma separated things so that I can send an email quickly. They might possibly do it at 3 o'clock. If they do, I will still send a mail to all of you. But if not, I've just got this printed. So you can have this. Anyway, you are not like first year BTEC student, so I guess you can type pretty fast. So typing out some program, in any case, you have to modify that program significantly. So that should be all right. Okay, so today we are essentially going to consider programming examples, but first we'll begin with a quiz. So here is a quiz on the technology of past. We all know memory, right? So which technology was used in the earliest digital computer? Was it magnetic core? Was it electronic walls? Was it semiconductor memory? Was it cathode ray tube? Or it was none of these? You should be able to answer it in about 30 seconds. I'll give you 30 seconds and then we'll collect responses by raising of hands. Thought about it? Okay. So choice A, raise your hands. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Not half raised. You might be confused, but you have to raise your hand fully. So 6. Okay. Choice B, which is electronic walls. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. Okay. Choice C, semiconductor memory. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Boy, we seem to have a divided opinion. Choice D, cathode ray tube. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Choice E, none of these. Fairly large number. 18, roughly. Okay. If I add these up, they don't add up to the total number present in the class. For the actual CS101 course, we are going to use special handheld devices. You would have seen them in series like Kaun Banega Crorepati, where audience response is collected. So people press in some 30 seconds, 1 minute or whatever, and then the collated response is displayed. That's the fastest way of getting a response for quiz. Observe that if you have to conduct a paper quiz of this kind, a more serious one, it will take at least 20 minutes to conduct a 2 minute quiz. And then evaluation is about it. So those devices, just to tell you some happening over the last year, I thought of this last January. And a colleague of mine who retired from the Institute, Professor Arvind Kutchatkar, told me that he had used those devices in Gujarat, in the Petrochemical University, for a class of 60 students. And he could buy them for $30 a piece from US. And then I followed it up. I asked that gentleman to come here, the representative. But when he came here, he said the cost is 2,500 rupees per piece. So I asked him, $30 don't amount to that, because a dollar was maximum 50 rupees. says, no sir, if you import, the cost is more. And then he says, this is only for the clickers. The software, the receiver, everything will be another $10,000. I gave him a cup of tea and asked him to get out. And then I asked our affordable solutions lab, which I had set up some 5 years ago. The objective of that lab is to take any technology solution and recreate an acceptable solution at 1/10 of the cost. That is the motto. They have never succeeded in doing that, but they have been able to provide 1/3 to 1/4 cost to half the cost, which is not bad. So they came up with a study of the bill of materials and so on, and they said, I told them to make it in 250 rupees, which they said can't do it. But they estimated they can do it in about 700 rupees. So then we spent time, got an embedded system design group established, they designed the clicker, and the prototype was created by students like you, by the way, meaning people who are not passed out, but people who come for summer internship during their second year, third year. So the people from, I think, Jaipur and Nagpur and some place, I had lots of students last year summer, and they actually built a working prototype using a Texas Instrument chip. You remember what I said about the size of the executable? Now you can see why that is important in some cases. Anyway, then of course the design and all took a long time. We used a cover khoka of the remote, TV remote, which was available cheaply. And I actually used it as a sort of on a sampling basis in my last CS101 class, but I had only about 50 of them ready. Then I could get about 850 of them, which I used in the teacher's workshop that I conducted, which I mentioned, the remote places, some 30 remote centers, 850 people attended that workshop. So I would display a quiz here, they would respond from those clickers there, and I would collect the data here. That is what we are going to do for CS101. As about the right answer for this quiz, the correct answer is cathode ray tube. This was used on the world's first program when it was executed on the digital computer. It was not an American computer, by the way. That development was happening in Europe and America at that time almost simultaneously. But the first recorded program to execute on a digital computer happened in June 1946. And that computer had no storage. So what they did is they used a cathode ray tube. They used dot and dash to represent 0 and 1. Now, a cathode ray tube, because of the refresh, a dot can remain as a dot for a long time, a dash can remain as a dash for a long time. So they put some capacitive plates on top, which could sense whether something was dot or something was dash. Okay. They had a phenomenal amount of memory of, I think, 32 words. So 32 lines, each line so many bits. That was a very odd kind of technology. It never sold in the market, although they produced something. And it soon gave way to magnetic core technology, which gave persistence. Cathode ray tubes have never been used to build memory. Cathode ray tubes have been used extensively in the early days to build electronic circuits for ALU, for CPU and everything. But they were never used for this thing. And semiconductor memory is a much recent phenomenon. Of course, for you, it's a very old phenomenon. For an ancient person like me, it is a recent phenomenon. So now we don't talk of magnetic core memory. We don't talk of any other technology. We talk only of semiconductor memory. Anyway, this I thought was just matter of some interest. So we will have in the courses, most probably not only in this course but other course also, because once we issue the clickers to first year students, other teachers can also use them, and we will be using these. So consequently, as one of the TA duties, you have to evaluate quiz papers. That job is taken care of. It's an automatic evaluation. Okay. You remember the goof up I made in the morning, and two of you kindly corrected me that the first dash is for something else. So you noted that the first character is for, if there is a dash, it's ordinary files, and if it's D's, file is a directory. I was just curious, so I went back to the ls command. The man ls unfortunately does not tell you complete details. So I found out that there are info docs actually as part of the Unix. These were introduced by GNU people, essentially the great promoter of open source, Richard Stallman. He originally developed this idea. And there are info docs which give many more details. So the command to get more information about any command is to say info followed by ls. And this is what I could call out. So this is the list of all file types that you see. We saw regular file, all right. B means block special file. Typically disk files will be block files. C is character special file. So all devices like keyboard and all, which interact with the Unix machine as character devices. Remember, Unix treats everything as a file, but it's a character file. The capital C denotes high performance file. What I told you that the file system will allocate, deallocate blocks and so on. So as a result, you would have frittered blocks for a given file. Now if you are doing high volume data processing, you would like the data to be on contiguous disk blocks so that you can read them faster or write them faster. So a capital C will ensure that kind of file. D is for directory. Capital D is a very funny thing which came up with Solaris. Essentially, this capital D door or the name pipe small p are very similar in concept. I have not explained to you the notion of pipe, so let me very briefly tell you that. So when you have a process P running, let's say P1, it will throw its output on std out. Suppose you simultaneously want another process P2 to run, but it should not collect its input independently from you or from any other file, but it should collect its input on std in from this std out itself. So consequently, what you want to do is you want to construct a pipe between these two processes. And the way to indicate this to Unix is on the command line, if you say P1, the first process will be executed. If you say vertical bar, which is the pipe symbol, and P2, then basically Unix loads both the programs P1 and P2 in memory. Both are executed. But if P2 requires some input, it will wait till some output is created by P1. If P1 has created a lot of output which fills up this pipe, because physically pipe will be some segment of memory, and that memory allocated fills up, then P1 execution will wait till P2 consumes something. And you can actually create as many pipes as you want. This is one of the important flexibility that Unix operating system introduced early in 70s. Okay. Now these pipes are ordinarily pipes that you create just by this symbol. But imagine if you have a large shell script, some 200 commands are being executed, and wherein you have multiple processes to handle. And now you want some processes to have a pipe, some other processes also to have a pipe, but these two pipes should be separate. So if you want to name those pipes, you can actually create pipe and name those pipes, and then give a command, not like this. You can say P1 greater than my pipe less than P2, something like that. Okay, so you can actually create pipes like this. Anyway, so there are multitude of things, and you can examine all of these. You are all familiar with socket programming. Okay, so if you want to refer to sockets or ports, S and P are the things. And if Unix gets completely confused about what the file is, then it will put a question mark. Okay. So now we will go over to some programming examples quickly. The objective of the examples that I am showing you here is to share with you how these problems will be explained to first year BTech students. So there are necessarily some simplifications, some additional explanations, etc., which you won't find at your level of program. But I want you to get into the mindset that, like, if I'm a first year BTech student and I'm asking you some question, then how you have to explain? Just giving correct technical information is not enough for me to understand. And therefore, not only in the classes, but even in the labs or in discussion session or consultation session, you know, keep that in mind, that those people know much less than what you do. And therefore, you are assuming the context is not correct. You will have to sort of go down to that level. So here is a, oh, what happened? Suppose an arrow is given which has roll numbers and marks. Incidentally, the roll numbers are given in ascending order, but they need not be. You basically want to teach people how you can read these many roll numbers and marks into arrays, and then given a roll number, how you can search that roll number and get the marks for that student. So there is of course a lot of explanation of what an array is and how the array elements can be indexed by an index expression, and by varying the index value you can set up an iteration, etc., etc. So this is a sample program which is given, that is a array of 100 elements for roll and marks. We presume that some code is here which will read all the data in the two arrays, and now here we are trying to explain how will you search for a given roll number. So a given roll is read in by the scene statement, and then I have this iteration for I equal to 0 to less than n students. I just compare roll I equal given roll. If it is, I say found marks is equal to marks I. And at the end of this, I will just say C out marks for given roll are found marks, return 0. So I found a fellow, I get out. If I don't find a fellow, I go back again. After showing this program, we ask the students, what do you think are the problems with this? So I suppose you can all guess that if I give a roll number which does not exist, okay, what will this program do? Sorry? Yes. So this program can have a possible problem if the given role does not exist in the array, maybe due to a mistake in input, the program will still print some garbage value. Now here is a point that I want you also to remember. We have such logical errors in our programs, large programs. If we get a value which is clearly impossible, like 57,000 marks, nobody gets 57,000 marks in any exam in India. So that is, there is a mistake. But suppose the trash value at that location is 65. 65 out of 100 decent marks, possible, right? So you might assume that the program is logically correct. That is where we introduce to the students the need for debugging and while or hand execution of the code. And when the programs become large, you require debugging tools, which I will briefly describe. DDD is the debugger that is favorite here. I don't know what debuggers you have used, but it is very similar to anything else that you would have used. But the need for that. The second point, the notion of algorithmic complexity is introduced even at the first year BTech level in a very rudimentary sense. So there is a previous example of estimation of pi, which is what I use by estimating the area or the number of points lying within a circle if you digitize a square superimposed on a circle, etc. I'm not discussing that point. The issue is that they have been told about order n square kind of complexity. So here we are trying to say is that obviously if I have to search through n elements, the order of complexity is order n. Then I use this opportunity to introduce the notion of binary search. Now before that, we have already explained to them through some other examples, some simple numeric analysis problems, like finding out the value of logarithm of x. So you take the log x and you do a tangential thing, so best you keep bettering the estimate and then reach the logarithm value. Similarly, a root by bisection method has been taught to them earlier. So what I do typically is that I take this bisection method and relate it to binary search in a slightly different or slightly more elaborate fashion. So I say that finding a root by the bisection method is simple. You go to a midpoint, and if the value of the function is on the value of the function of high side, then you search, your search space is this, otherwise your search space is this. So basically, we say start with a low and high value such that the product of the function values are is less than 0, because one of the values must be positive, one of the values must be negative for the function to cross over x-axis where the root is. Then we say compute midpoint and function value at midpoint, and depending upon whether that midpoint is, whether it is function is greater than 0 or some small threshold value, you want to go as close to 0 as possible. You will never get in floating point arithmetic f of some value as exact 0. So you say some threshold 0.001 or whatever, whatever, and if you reach that, you finish. Otherwise, locate the next interval to be either low to mid or mid to high. So this is the example that you are essentially taking a search space which is this big, and you are reducing it by half in one shot, and next time you are reducing it by half in one shot. So if I can do this with real light, can I not do this with array elements? That's the point that we try to motivate people. So what I do is to show that I actually consider x-axis as a set of discrete points. So notice that these points are essentially ordered. This is a smaller value, next higher value, etc., etc. So I have now an ordered or sorted array, sort of. And then at each point, I am examining the function value, which is like marks obtained by a student. So if the whole numbers are sorted, what is the analogy or simile of this approach of bisection method with binary search? So what I do is, I simply put that diagram like this and say that, look, if the x-axis is discretized, then the points on x-axis can be considered to be points in my array, which are values in my, the key value, which is sorted. And just like I go for a midpoint, which on real line could be any arbitrary point, but for integer index, I will go to either this point or whatever. So in just as in one shot, I was reducing the low to high search space to either low to mid or mid to high. Similarly, I will be reducing the search space to half. I have found that this kind of simple graphical explanation goes a long way to explain the concept. After this, we of course say that, look, if you have to do this, then you can write a binary search algorithm. And then this role mid, etc., is indicated. Incidentally, I often, okay, so this will actually find out if the role is equal to given role. It will set up a flag, it will show. Then I ask the students that in the assignment, you run this program, and you run it finding out in each iteration what is the low value, what is the high value, and what is the midpoint. That is why deliberately a few elements are given initially, like 7, 8, 10, 12, etc., less than 60. So they can even hand execute it. They can certainly execute it. And that is roughly the time when they would have learned debugger, DDD. So they could execute it using DDD and actually monitor the points. Now, I don't know which way you learn these things, but you will agree that a little explanation of this kind would be useful for the first year BTech students. So that's the approach that we do. And incidentally, the assignment that has been given is merely to buttress the same thing. So what we have given is an ordinary C program, C++ program, which reads the text file, okay? And then there is an iteration which says, give me a roll number and I will search that value. What we are asking you to do is replace the reading of the array by a function, which actually will read the text file, the data into the array, then sort the array. The given data happens incidentally to be in sorted order of roll numbers, but which need not be so. So you sort that array, and the actual search routine should be binary search. Why I want you to write this program is not a very big deal for you, but when you actually write, execute, you'll go through GCC compilation on a Unix environment, etc., because that is where the students will be asking you problems. And in any case, it is useful for you to get familiar with the environment. So that is the purpose. There are a few more examples which I would like to quickly describe. Okay. Remember, I told you that you will have to set question paper questions in the exams as TAs in any course that you are associate with. Let me first show you the problem that was given to me as a programming problem by one of the TAs last year. So he says, given two arrays A and B, if X is an element of A and Y is an element of B, such that if these two are swapped, so one element of A array is pushed into array B, and Y element of array B is pushed into array A. Then if you take the sum of all the elements, those sums should be equal. That's the problem. Initially, whether they are equal or not doesn't matter, but after the swap, they should be equal. And the problem was find out such X and Y. I thought this problem was too hypothetical. So what I did is I constructed a sort of a realistic looking problem, which was this problem. The problem is there are two trucks in which packages are there weighing different weights. We assume for simplicity that weights are integer. And now we wish to balance the load. We say that initially they are imbalanced. But we want to find out exact one pair of packages, one here, one there, so that one Hammal takes out that package, puts it here, takes up this package, puts it there, minimize effort. Can you find such thing, given all the weights of different packages in truck A and truck B? Notice that this problem is exactly the same as that. But you will agree that if the problem is posed in this fashion, students can relate because they can imagine trucks, they can imagine packages, they can imagine weights, and they can see that this is what is happening. Why I will also be giving prize with this example in the on the 20th in the convocation hall. The objective is to say that even otherwise, programming is not done to solve hypothetical problems. Programming is always done to solve real life problems, except of course by mathematicians who are doing theorem proving and other things. So it is always useful. While there could be very interesting programming problems which you would like to put together, such as this, it is always useful if you could somehow restate that problem, programming problem, in terms of some real life problem. Because then everybody, whether they are students of first year level or as old as me, 62 years old, we will all find it easier to relate to that problem. And we will learn another important thing. Given a real life problem, how do we translate or model that problem in a programming paradigm? So these are two very important things which I believe are useful. So the next slide actually indicates the thinking, which says initially I would think, how will I represent the problem data? So since we'll be required to compare weights of packages from each truck with those in the other, the best way would be to read the respective load values into arrays. That means all package values are available. Now assuming maximum number of packages in each truck to be 100, now that's an assumption I am making. We will use integer arrays A and B of size 100, each having some M and N elements respectively representing the weights. It is important to convey to students to state those assumptions here. Because otherwise in the program you directly file A500, A5000, A200 with no reason or rhyme. There is still no reason or rhyme, but it states that I have made a conscious assumption. And if this assumption is stated, even in the documentation of the program, either inline documentation or outside, we will tell the students that it will enhance the value of their program. Then what should our program find? So we are saying there may exist pairs of elements of the type X and Y such that X is an element of array A, Y is an element of array B, and if I swap X and Y, then the resultant array will have the property that sum of elements of new array A is equal to sum of elements of new array B. Observe that this was the original problem which a TA wrote. It's a good problem. But you will agree that stated in this fashion, it perhaps makes more sense. Now one possible algorithm we say is to iterate on one array B, and for every element of array B which represents some weight Y, find the permissible value of X. So how do you find permissible value of X? That is, given a Y, what should be X so that it can be swapped? Well, that can be done because you want the total balance. So you have to obviously find the sum of all weights originally, and then find out for any Y what should be possible X. Knowing possible X, now you iterate around the array A to find out whether such X exists. And if it does, the problem is solved. So this is an example program. So it declares the two arrays A and B. It declares M and N as number of elements, and then of course index values, etc. Sorry, there is a syntax error here. Have you spotted it? Wonderful. In spite of all possible care, okay. hell do you go? Okay. So first I read numbers into arrays, read m elements, then read n and read n elements in D. Then find sum of all elements of each array. Okay. This could have been easily done combining with the reading, but there is a matter of style. Generally you would like to have input operation completely independently, a separate function, and then any manipulation separately. Then I find out the difference. Then I do a curious thing. If difference modulo 2 is not equal to 0, I say the difference of sums is not even, therefore desired elements do not exist. Can you reach this conclusion? Yes, but you have to formulate that. And it is not necessary that everyone will automatically think of this. So it is useful to point this out through a series of comments. Justification for the difference to be even. So after swapping x from a and y from b, if the loads are balanced, we will have sum 1 minus x plus y equal to sum 2 minus y plus x, because you have swapped these. And this equation modifies to this, where you essentially get sum 1 minus sum 2, which is the difference, equal to 2 times x minus y. X and y are two integers. Okay, so the difference is an integer and 2n is a even number. So that is why we say that unless the difference is even, you cannot have a solution. Okay. So we have found that out. This also, people should be encouraged to think like that, because what they are doing effectively is they may not be changing the order of complexity of the algorithm, but they are drastically reducing the execution time. You remember, you have two order n square algorithms, where one is say 5 n square plus 72 n plus something, and the other is 25 n square plus 2 n plus something. Now the 25 n square is going to cause very heavy weight. So those coefficients do matter, and therefore if you reduce a large slice, so you can explain that if you go by the law of averages, okay, then half the time, actually it is not half because it will, the probability will work out slightly differently, but effectively you are reducing that much in computation time. So now locate the elements meeting the criteria. If x is element of A and y is element of B, we need to find x and y such that this. In general, for some j, we are looking at bj. Then for some I, we must have y equal to sum 1 minus sum 2 plus bj. This is a mistake. Can you find that out? Well, this equation is wrong. It is not sum 1 plus, it should be sum 1 plus y minus x equal to sum 2 plus y, etc., etc. I have obviously taken some slides from an older version which had a mistake than this. So that's okay, you can correct it, I suppose. Anyway, so this is what you do. You find out what is the probable x. This is again a wrong value. It should be sum 1 minus sum 2 by 2 plus bj. And when you get that, you search this out and get out. Now here effectively you are saying that you are doing a scan on array B, taking one element, and then you are doing a complete scan on array A, taking another element. So some discussion on algorithmic complexity. If m is equal to n, the problem is size is n. And since we already explained to the students that algorithmic complexity has a meaning only when n is tending to infinity. And when m and n tend to infinity, they are roughly same. So the order of size or the size of the problem can be considered to be n. And then we say that since we have an outer iteration which executes n time, and every time for each outer iteration we have an inner iteration which again executes n time, the algorithm complexity is order n square. And this is where we relate this problem to the binary search problem. We say that if the second array was sorted, or in this case the first array, if array A was sorted, the inner array, then I could use binary search to find out. So if one of the two arrays is sorted, then the search will be done in log n to the base 2 times, and therefore the algorithmic complexity will reduce to n log n to the base 2. And we will say that in similar real life situations, where we are not talking of balancing load on trucks, but we are talking of, let's say, doing some kind of finding out matches against millions of records or millions of things, these things would matter helpful. So this is generally the tenor of programming courses here, the introductory programming courses here. Here is another example where we have earlier discussed in the class the limitations on floating point numbers. So all of you are familiar that because of the limited precision, if you add, let's say, to an Avogadro number which is 10 to the power 37, you add some 0.357, nothing will happen because the precision is way beyond the capacity of representation. And then we say in real life we do need to handle larger precision. So how can we do that? Can we have a 50 digit precision? Can we have a 70 digit precision, which ordinary programming languages do not provide? So as an example, I usually give this example which says that numbers with much higher precision could be represented inside if I decide to represent one digit of a high precision number by one element in an array. Now if I have a large array, then I can represent that as use that array to represent a very large high precision number. So the example of course given here is on integer high precision numbers. But in real life, we usually give a reference to the beautiful book on numerical recipes. Have you read that book? Anybody? Numerical recipes in Fortran, numerical recipes in C, numerical recipes in C++, numerical recipes in Java. The same numerical recipes which the authors have been rewriting in different programming languages. They are one of the best books in computational algorithms, real life implementation. So whether it is finding out simultaneous equation solution, differential equation, n number of things, okay, roots of function, whatever. Beautiful book. And it has actual code which solves the problem. So you people being computer science students, you're more interested in computer science ways, not the mathematical numerical problem solution way. But if you take mechanical engineers, civil engineers, aerospace engineers, people who deal with structures, finite element techniques, etc., invariably they will require this kind of mathematics. And since the first year course is taught to students of all branches, you would remember in your colleges also, students of mechanical, electrical would also have done that programming course. They would be expected to handle such things, so it is useful to give a small example even in a first course. So we say that since arrays can be used to represent high precision numbers, however, the natural plus minus multiply divide operations of C will not work because this is not a normal number. So we will have to write programs to do all of these. And as an example, we say we will consider the problem of adding two high precision numbers. So how do we represent such high precision numbers? So this is one arbitrary representation that we represent a number in an array such that the zeroth element in C has the number of digits in that high precision number. And num1, num2, num3, etc. are actual individual digits. So this is a reasonable representation. We can now represent two such numbers in arrays M and N. Assuming a number has a maximum 99 digits, we use M100 and N100. Because one position is lost in keeping the number of numbers. Please note that this representation does not permit negative numbers to be stored. So that we introduce later by saying that you will additionally need a psi. So, and that can be easily done by putting the number of digits as positive or negative. So the sign can be accommodated because after all each memory location itself is a full-fledged integer value. And then we say we may now write a program to add these two numbers and store the result in another array, say R. And we explain why R101 is there because when you add, the result might have an extra digit. So why is the size of R1 more than M1? And we let people think that if I have to multiply two high precision integer numbers, the size will have to be like almost double. Now, we discuss how difficult it is to add numbers given this representation. For example, the numbers will be given in this form. Say 4 digits, 9521. 6 digits, 996357. So when I read this input into my arrays, I will have M04, which is 4 digits, and then M1, M2, M3, M4 containing 9521, which are the individual digits of this number. Exactly the same thing for the array N. N0 will be 6, which is the number of digits in that large number. It's not exactly large, but a representation. And now we point out that even if we have these digits in individual elements of the array, it does not appear straightforward for me to add, because this is not the way I add numbers. So we explain that the way I will add number is, I will first align the numbers on the right and then perform the addition digit by digit. So when I shift the numbers to the right, I would like to have zero zeros here. I need to shift only the number with smaller number of digits to right, because then it will get aligned anyway. Now, in general, I do not know how many digits are there in any number. So then as one strategy, what I say is that I use, say, two temporary arrays called M dash and N dash. And I will take the M and N array numbers and push them all the way to the right. So they are always right justified. So M dash will contain the same number to the rightmost column, rightmost element, and N dash will contain the same. We also observe that the addition is not simple, add this and put the result here. So any digit position, suppose I am adding here, I have to add not only 5 and 3, but also a possible carry which could have come up from previous operation. And we explain here itself how an iteration can be set around these positions. If every time we add the two corresponding digits and a carry, the carry may be 0, carry may be 1. And if after the last digit or the most significant digit is added, if there is still a carry, that is where an extra position is required for the number. So then the algorithm to be used is, you have read the numbers in M and N. Now you shift all these M and N all the way to the right and then add them like this. So this is what we do. Incidentally, last year I had used this opportunity for the first time to explain the question mark operator. All of you are familiar with this. It's a form of if. Now, invariably in the textbooks and in most of the teaching, we find this is taught or this is discussed along with the if statement. When there is no natural need to discuss this. In fact, we generally do not like discussing elements of programming language piecemeal by piecemeal. There is no concept which is introduced without an example. There is always a programming example in which a concept comes, and then that concept, we believe, sticks better in the minds of people. We are trying to propagate that method of teaching everywhere in the country, but this is what we do here. So immediately after showing this slide, I verbally explain what this does, and then of course I start with carry equal to 0, I is 99, I greater than equal to 900 syntax error. This is of course Microsoft stupidity. Any isolated I will be capitalized automatically. So, at many places I have taken care, but this one remained. Anyway, and then you will notice that I have shifted the numbers to R dash, to M dash and N dash. So, I am using that from the last position backwards. And whatever is the, if the, this is greater than 9, then they should take the digit to be modulo 10, because it is 12, so the result will be 2. If it is 17, the result will be 7 and carry 1, like that. And then we modify the carry and go on. And just to make sure that the verbal explanation of this particular construct is understood, I usually repeat the slide and say that this means if M0 is greater than N0, then max digit is M0, else max digit is N0. And once again, buttress the fact that this kind of construct is to be used only when the left-hand side of the possible assignment is same, max digits or something. And either this value or that value is the construct when you use this. So these are the kind of examples. By the way, a question paper in the mid-sem contained, having explained this before the mid-sem, they had to subtract numbers. So they had to work out the negative number representation, and they had to do now a borrow instead of a carry. And in spite of the hustle bustle of an exam, I tell you, I mean, this is where it's extremely satisfying for a teacher. There were several students who wrote a composite program which could do either addition or subtraction. So their representation was meticulous and their computations was good. And they could write, I mean, fairly good program in a 2-hour test. So that is where practice counts. If people have written lots of programs, then these constructs and segments will automatically sort of flow from your head. That is what should happen. Given all this, we still need to debug programs. So I don't know which debuggers have you used in your programming? or you did not use any formal debugging tool? Okay, GDB, that's more popular, is it? Okay. Everybody is familiar with some debugging tool or the other? Or if some people have never used a debugger, please raise your hands because this is important. One, two, three, okay. Never used debugger. Okay, fine. So how did you find your errors in the program? Or if somebody goes back and examines your final project report, the programs are actually not run. No, that is likely for other reasons. But particularly when your programs become large and there is some error in some segment. I don't know, but I find it extremely difficult to locate it easily. So some debugging tool is very, very essential. Anyway, what we use for the first year course is DDD, but GDB is also quite popular here. And I would strongly suggest that you spend some time getting acquainted with GDB. Unfortunately, this is not an Ubuntu machine, so I can't show the DDD here, but I have some slides here. These slides I will put up in the final common directory when you get it on the Moodle or something, so you can look at that. But you can execute DDD on your own for any one of these programs, and you can see how you can step through, how you can find out values and so on. DDD or any debugging tool is not very difficult. Conceptually, it is easier to imagine that you have an animator or an animated execution of your program. As lines are being executed, somebody is trapping each execution, a value of some variable changes, and you are able to observe the change value, if you wish, after every statement execution. So instead of hand executing, you can actually give the data, and the machine will execute step by step. If you do not want that, but you want to stop if a particular value changes by this much or something, you can set what is known as breakpoints. So in your program, you say that if the index becomes larger than 10, I want to stop and I want you to show me the value of this variable or this element of the array, etc. It's a graphical tool and extremely versatile. It will not take you more than 10 minutes to figure out how to handle that, but believe me, it is worth it to do it. Even for you, for me, for everybody, it is still worth it to understand a good debugging tool and use that. So this is some explanation of the debugging tool. Essentially, it monitors program execution as a front-end command line debugger. So it can debug executable binaries, it can debug Java bytecode programs, Python, Perl, Bash programs, anything. Okay. That is the reason why DDD is perhaps more popular among some people. Invoking DDD, you just say either DDD and then you will get a blank window. Of course, there will be no program there. In which case, you go to a file option inside that DDD and load a particular. Otherwise, you can simply say DDD executable. Okay. If you know the process ID number, you can also give that. Quitting is very simple. In the file option, you say exit or quit or control Q. What is important is navigating through code. So, before you use DDD, you must let the compiler know that you are going to use a debugger later. See, debugger is not black magic. So while you compile the code, there must have been certain hooks maintained which the debugger will use. So you have to inform the compiler that I intend to execute this program with a debugging option. And consequently, you can say GCC minus G or C++ minus G. Okay. Well, when you invoke the compiler, minus G will mean you are wanting to use a debugger later. And then, of course, you can open the file or open the source inside the DDD. You can look up definitions of various values and various variables and so on. You can create breakpoints, as I mentioned. So stop the program execution at some point. So line number 40. Now, of course, you will not stop it if it is a plain sequential instruction, but obviously iterations, iterations within iteration. You give a line number, then when you run the program, every time the execution comes to that instruction, you will stop. And at that point, if you have highlighted certain variables or array elements, etc., for display, then those values at that instance will be displayed. It's almost like hand execution, except it is done far more rapidly, far more conveniently, and you don't have to go through every iteration for say 10,000 iterations. You can actually assign breakpoints, some values and variety of it. Watch points are stopping the program not at a particular line number, but whenever a value of the expression goes beyond a certain value, beyond the threshold values. and you can interrupt any time by pressing escape. If you just want to run the program, you can run. There is an execution window which comes, which is exactly like your terminal if you are executing a program. So if there is a Cin statement, you give some input value in that execution window, and the program execution can also be seen. So as I said, this is a very beautiful graphical way of executing your program, but under your control, step by step. Those of you who have never used a debugger will really enjoy doing this. So in the lab today, rather than writing that C program, although that is what I expect that you should submit a file. So whatever file it is, it will be a CPP file, you can submit it. Ordinarily, there are multiple files to be submitted. As you would have seen in the morning, you would convert them into a tar file and you upload a single tar file. That will be the normal precon. But I would definitely like you to grab this opportunity to become familiar with the debugger. Once you use one debugger thoroughly, you can convert to any other debugger without any problem. But in particularly those of you who are inclined towards implementation oriented activities rather than theoretical research will find this extremely useful. And just to tell you that, some of the best theoreticians, computer scientists in the world are here with us. And many of them are better programmers than many implementation oriented guys. So theory and practice are not contraindicated. Good theory does not mean that you must not practice what you preach. Nor good practice means you should be devoid of theoretical understanding. These are two sides of a coin. Anyway, so this is all that I wanted to say today. There are n number of other details. You can actually look at the DDD documentation to note more. But I tell you, by reading documentation, not much is understood. You have to dirty your hands. So play with it for fun and say today and on Monday to the extent that you can. And in general also later on, it's worthwhile playing and mastering that. Because in any course project that you do later during the semester or in your final year project, if you have to do implementation, then believe me, the two things that will help you tremendously in saving time and achieving faster results, one is the version control system and the other is a good debug. These would be required. So this is not for the sake of first year students, first year BTech students. This is for our own sake that we should do this. Is that okay? Fine. So any queries, since we still have about 3, 4, 5 minutes? Any general questions? Anything? Anything under the sun? We'll still have to continue with a single login ID, Raju, is it? By the way, Raju Chintala and Swapnil are the senior TAs for CS101, and there were supposed to be two other people who are coordinating this TA orientation program, but they are missing. Yeah. Wonderful. Okay. They presume that you will take the responsibility. Nagesh, can you just show your face to them? Nagesh is my research associate. He joined me about 5 years ago from Goa Engineering College, and he is deeply involved in both the national mission projects that we are doing as well as the programming courses. In fact, he had written a book sort of, 5, 6 years ago on detail, 8 years ago. I went through that book. It's an extremely good collection of very many important things. I requested him to open source it. That means release it openly, and he has agreed to do that, but he would like to edit it. But I have convinced them that you should not be worried about mistakes, and you should certainly not be worried about some people pointing out mistakes. You saw me making mistakes here, right? So you, all of us can make mistakes. So I have convinced them to release that book. We'll put it on the either the Institute Wiki or CS101 homepage or something. And along with the BTech students, you can also read it. It is useful. In general, you should depend more on internet resources rather than physical book resources or volume. That is the morale of the current era. So you will find, for example, Wiki to contain beautiful technical explanations on points which are not so well covered even in textbooks. I don't know, all of you have read Wikipedia? How many of you have never seriously searched Wikipedia for any problem? Everybody has. Okay, so tell me, what is the best on programming that you got from Wikipedia. See, that's the point. You will search Wikipedia, but you will search Wikipedia for general problem. You will believe that specific technical points will probably not be as well covered in Wikipedia as you would want to. That is not so. You take image file formats. Anybody who has done any image processing? Okay. So you take image file formats. Okay. All of them are better covered in Wikipedia than many textbooks that one sees. BMP format, for example, the complete code for BMP format, the standard for BMP format is best described in Wikipedia rather than any other text. So such is the power of the internet resources. And our endeavor through the CS101 program and through the national mission is actually to launch a nationwide portal on computer programming, where all open source resources classified, categorized properly would be available. So those of you who ultimately become TAs for CS101 will actually be contributing towards that effort as well, by not necessarily by contributing questions yourself, but by editing, correcting the programs that students submit, and by ensuring that those are in presentable form. That will be one of the activities. Okay, so that's all I have. Unfortunately, there can't be any communication between us because there is no Moodle. So in the assignment, all of you can access email, right? So I've given two email IDs, one is mine and one is Raju Chintala's, who is the coordinating TA. So at the end of the day, you just mail your, you have to mail only one file, the final program that you write, and just mail it to him, that's all. And use this opportunity to, you know, sort of figure out as much as you can. Tomorrow, of course, is Sunday, so you should all relax. As Professor Sanya said, you should also have some fun in life. So you should have real fun tomorrow. Go out in the nice rainy season to Vihar Lake or some such place. Picnic, rainy season picnic, but don't fall ill. And come back on Monday morning. I think you have got a schedule copy also. So we'll continue with that schedule. But you will have a programming test. And this is like a regular programming test, like C programming test you would have given, what, 4 years ago? Okay, something like that. So it need not be C, it could be C or C++. But it is essentially a C++ program. I'm presuming that all of you are familiar with C++, at least either of them. Fair enough. Okay. Because one thing that we will be doing is, I will be setting up the question paper for that test. Before that, you will be setting up questions for a hypothetical test. So you will see the wording of your questions and the wording that comes out in the final test. And finally, evaluating papers, you will have to evaluate papers of the students for whom you are TAs in whichever course. So what we will do is, your test papers will be evaluated by yourselves, but in a pipeline fashion, so we will simulate how question papers are evaluated for large course. It will be fun. Right. Any other suggestions, ideas? Nothing. 20th, as you know from the schedule, is the institute day. They have said that they will cover Moodle in the afternoon extensively. So that is why I am removing emphasis on Moodle. You should be able to see Moodle. Moodle is also an excellent learning management system. And now that you have LDAP IDs, go to the Institute Moodle. Doesn't matter whether you are not registered for course. Actually, you should be able to see the courses that you are registered for. But you can also see a number of other things. And just examine, you know, what are the features, what is the discussion forum, okay, what are the links for various things, schedules, etc., etc. It makes life far simpler and very organized. So that is the objective. All right. Yeah, please.
I just want to share something.
Yeah.
So topcoder.com has very good tutorials on C and C++.
Who?
Topcoder.com.
Just speaking that, because they are recording everything.
So the topcoder.com has very good tutorials on C and C++ programming. I mean, it even has Java, C# and all, but yeah, C++ is.
Topcoder.com.
Yeah.
But are they open source?
I'm not sure if they're open source, but yeah, they do share content about programming.
There is a ticklish issue, you know, that if something is not open source, then we hesitate in putting it in public domain ourselves. we can give a link saying go there. But our notion is that if my people require access, then it is best obtained if the information is on a local server. See, India is very special as compared to many other nations because internet bandwidths are still highly limited. So you take your institutions, for example. I have seen many cities in which colleges have less internet bandwidth than a cyber cafe. And many students actually go to cyber cafe to interact with internet. Now, given this situation, if you have heavy usage by, let's say, 300, 400 students on some particular resource on internet, it will be impossible. So what is the best way? You actually mirror. You create a mirror site and inside your organization. Our notion of open source is that our open source servers, which are there under a Clever project or National Mission project, things are downloadable. Anybody makes a request for any portion, we actually put it in DVDs and ship it, saying you install it on your own servers. So open source should be to the extent that nobody should question, saying that IIT Bombay or FATAC or anybody has violated an intellectual property regime. So if Max, can you just check this top coder thing? We'll see if they have a license. And these Western societies are very peculiar about it. On one hand, they are very possessive about the intellectual property. Similarly, they are extremely clear about the legal provisions. On the other hand, they will be very dicey in the wording, so they will never say whether this is open source or not. 4-5 years ago, we had a situation where somebody had kept a tutorial on the website, and Sudarshan, my colleague from the database group, who is the author of that book on databases, decided that people wanted access, so he put that on a site here. And then he got a very sharp thing from that author of that tutorial, that how can you copy my tutorial and put it on the site? It's all right if anybody in the world sees and downloads his tutorial, but you can't put it on the server. So Professor Soumen Chakravarti, another flamboyant researcher, who actually is far better acknowledged as world's expert in data mining and text mining than that gentleman, he wrote a letter to him saying that we have kept it just because few people wanted it. We never believed that it was one of the better tutorials. We have deleted it since. So this kind of spat happens, you know. We would not like that to happen. So, but it's a good point that he's making. All of you should be on the lookout of resources in programming. They could be mutually beneficial, and additionally, they could be beneficial to these learners. And wherever you find a true open source thing, which means I can copy and distribute, that is open source, then we would be very glad to have them. Because on our Moodle, we keep all the resources which are accessible. So top coder, you said. Okay. Top coder, we'll examine that. Thanks. Any other question? Fine. So go ahead, enjoy the lab, and then enjoy the evening and night and tomorrow. Thank you.